When we think of Fred Astaire, it is perhaps inescapable that we think of Ginger Rogers. They made 9 incomparable musicals together in the 1930s and another in 1949. One critic said, in the Astaire-Rogers movies, the dancing is often the only real, the only serious business. Another called their dances the most exquisite courtship rites the screen has ever known. Ginger Rogers is speaking with us tonight from Medford, Oregon. Ms. Rogers, thank you very much for being with us. How were you able to create such magic?
Well, I really don't know. I think it was just, sort of came naturally to both of us. We were terribly pleased to be in the same film together. We'd met each other in New York some years previous to our making our first film at RKO. And so it was kind of wonderful that we could dance together. I'd never danced with him before, and I always admired him. And to think that suddenly I was going to make a film with him called Flying Down to Rio. And it was such a surprise to everyone that we were such a hit. It was to us, too, I must say.
And what was it like to dance with Fred Astaire?
Just wonderful. Wonderful.
And what made it so?
I think the joy of loving what you do. He loved dancing. He loved doing that kind of expression, and I did, too. And he was a perfectionist, and I like to think that I am a perfectionist as well. So it takes one to know one, and we both found that we loved it. We loved doing what we were doing.
Do you remember dancing in Follow the Fleet?
Follow the Fleet was a very nice film of Irving Berlin's, and we did a number of numbers together, one comedy number that we had never done before, I'm Putting All My Eggs in One Basket, and it was a great joy to be a loose type dance where it was a free-for-all.
I want to ask you, an awful lot of people say, listen, Fred Astaire, Ginger Rogers, these people have so much God-given talent, it's easy for them. Was it ever easy?
I don't think it's easy. I think it's very well rehearsed, and I think as long as something is well rehearsed, you have a chance to be, to have some, excellence in it if you really do give all to what you do. And he was always one to love to rehearse, and I did too, and 6 weeks of rehearsal before we started any film is what we always devoted.
I think when someone hears you say 6 weeks rehearsal, that tells them about all we need to know about how much hard work and sweat went into that.
That's true.
Thank you very much, Ginger Rogers.
It's very nice to talk with you. Thank
you.
You
take care. The joy of loving what you do. Most of the men who wrote the music Fred Astaire sang and danced and won our hearts with are dead now, but 99-year-old Irving Berlin today called Fred Astaire the purest talent I have ever worked with. Bruce Morton reports how others felt about that talent, and the tributes began in a darkened theater.
We would like to dedicate tonight's performance to Mr. Fred Astaire, the quintessential dancer.
That's how the musical Chorus Line opened tonight on Broadway. No wonder. Fred Astaire influenced just about every dancer for the last 50 years. Mikhail Baryshnikov learned his trade in Leningrad, but growing up there, his favorite dancer was American Fred Astaire.
Oh, his genius. And this phenomenal technique and he's looking himself from outside, cynical attitude to himself, you know, it's wonderful. It is wonderful.
Did he influence American ballet? You bet.
I saw his first film, Flying Down to Rio, when I was in high school, and I wanted to dance. I just wanted to be able to move like that and enjoy myself like that and have the fun that he seemed to be having.
Bill T. Jones is a modern dancer. Astaire's influence, you can see it as he moves.
He taught something about exuberance and cool, you know. He came across as if he had just walked in off the street. as if he had just today learned how to do those incredible turns or suspend in the way he was able to suspend.
Or you could talk to a young dancer in Alvin Ailey's New York company.
We all know his movies and his dancing and his style and stuff, and we use it in all of our dancing too.
Even Lionel Richie went dancing on the ceiling like Astaire. You can point to this dancer or that, this choreographer or that, but the fact is that two generations of dancers, American and foreign, have grown up watching these moves, these movies, tap, ballroom, jazz. You know what it's supposed to look like. It's supposed to look like that.
He was surely one of the dance geniuses of this century. I would rate him in his field right up there with Balanchine and Anthony Tudor and Robbins, anyone in the ballet world, or Martha Graham or Picasso. He represents, in his genre, that man of this century.
So he'll keep dancing, not just himself in the movies, but in rehearsal halls and classrooms and theater stages all over. For years to come, when somebody gets it really right, the critics will smile at each other and say, hey, almost as good as Astaire. Dan?
Thanks, Bruce. Now, the public life of Fred Astaire is so much a part of our heritage that it's easy to forget the private life he worked hard at keeping private. But in 1933, Fred Astaire married a society woman, Phyllis Potter. They were the parents of three children. She died in 1954. In 1980, Astaire, a successful horse owner, married jockey Robin Smith, who was 46 years younger than he. She was with him today at his death. But of course, it is Astaire, the master showman, we recall tonight. And Gene Siskel, the syndicated movie columnist and critic, is here to tell us what was so special about the movies of Fred Astaire. Good evening, Gene. Thanks for being with us tonight. How would you place Fred Astaire in the history of great film stars?
Well, I think you put him right up there. Let's say, as John Wayne was to the Western, Fred Astaire was to dance. As Bogart and Cagney were to the gangster pictures, Fred Astaire was to dance. He defined the genre. John Wayne once said to me that he thought the reason Westerns were so popular was that the horse was the perfect vehicle for showing motion on the screen. Well, I don't want to compare Fred Astaire to a horse, but he may have been the perfect human vehicle for expressing motion on the screen. You noticed him, if you watched all those clips, you noticed the dancing, not him, and that was key. You noticed the lyric, not him. That was very special.
But Gene, we all know that Fred Astaire could dance very well, but what was it, what did he do so special with dance in the movies?
Well, one thing he did is he insisted that he be shot full frame, he and Miss Rogers and his other partners. It wasn't cut up like they do with Flashdance or like all these music videos. He also told stories with his every move. He let his body do the talking. A great example of this is his edited version of the way in Top Hat he courts Ginger Rogers.
Gives a nice little whistle. He's going to try and get her to walk along. There's the encouragement. She will walk with him. Nice and slow and easy. So he'll pick up the pace a little bit. Hand in the pocket. There he goes. She's going to follow with him. She's together with him. She likes him. She's going to offer a little encouragement, a little stutter step. There. He sees it. That encourages him to charge ahead full steam, which he does. Courtship, not a word has been spoken, they're very much in love. And Dan, they can't take that away from us.
Gene, thank you very much. What a good point about the body language. I never really thought of that. Thanks for being with us.
My pleasure, Dan.
In 1951, Fred Astaire made the movie Royal Wedding. He made it with Jane Powell. She was the third choice. June Allison and Judy Garland had to be replaced. So the dance numbers already were choreographed, and Astaire and Powell could not create their dances together. Jane Powell is with us in our studio tonight, and what a joy to have you here.
Thank you, Dan.
Every woman, and I suppose every man, really wants to know in his own way, what was it like to dance with Fred Astaire, and what made him such a terrific dancer?
Well, Fred was unique in every way, in his family life, in his privacy that he kept, and that uniqueness he used in his work. He was everyone's dream. I think of him, in fact, I've thought about him so much today. I thought of him as a sophisticated little boy because he had such a wonderful zest for life. He had such a wonderful way of having fun. And everybody had fun in watching him. He would use things. He would take the hat rack, which we had in Royal Wedding. You saw that on the film clip. He would do something with it. And it was exactly what you would have liked to have done.
Well, let's take a look at that scene from Royal Wedding and tell me about this.
All right. This is, I believe it is going to be, how could you believe me when I told you that I loved you when you know I've been a liar all my life? The longest song title ever written. I love doing this number. As I say, I had never even met Fred until I did this. Now, when I'm going to do this and I was supposed to hit his foot, I was so afraid I was going to knock him out that I was a little bit overly cautious. I'm not even sure I touched his foot. But just to be in his presence, it was really quite magical, because I never knew what to talk to him about, because he wasn't very conversal. He didn't like to talk too much, and he was, being the private person that he was, you never want to interfere or infringe in his time. But he was probably one of the kindest people I have ever met. Of course, we all know he was a master, not only at his acting but also at his dancing, and I think that he was a masterful liver. He made people his life live. He made people appreciate him, and he's to be remembered really with the most glorious thoughts. How wonderful to go that way.
We should all be so lucky.
Oh,
and how
yes.
Pleased he would be to hear you say that he was a masterful liver. He might like to hear you say that better than to say he was a masterful dancer.
Well, I think to be great, you have to be able to do it all the nicest way you can, because we're here to give, and he gave so much of himself.
Jane Powell, thank you very much for being with us.
Thank you.
It's hard for people like Americans who are conditioned to believe in progress that the world may already have seen the best of anything. But so far, there's been only one William Shakespeare, only one Babe Ruth. So far, there's been only one Fred Astaire, who in his lifetime received the kind of homage often reserved for the dead. So that on a public occasion some years ago, an admirer turned to the poet John Milton to describe Astaire, and I quote, "Grace was in all his steps, heaven in his eye, and in every gesture, dignity and love." It has been at least a couple of movie generations since Fred Astaire danced for the cameras, but today the challenge still remains, who do you think you are, Fred Astaire? After all, he was a man who could make us forget, for a little while, the Great Depression. He could even make us forget World War II. And if you need to comprehend what we have lost today, just ask yourself, who is the next Fred Astaire? For CBS News, Dan Rather. Thank you for joining us. Good night.
This is CBS.